Welcome back to Community Crossfire, another point of view. I'm your host, Stormy Norman Oliver. I've been traveling the globe just enjoying life, and I want to thank my sister for doing the shows for me, and also Trippy Congo for coming in for 10 minutes and saying hi and bye. Thank you, Trippy Congo. God, a lot's happening. God, I on a sad note, a guy who's been working for me for about 15 years got stabbed on, I guess, around Rodney Street, went into the hospital, Alfredo, and died. I mean, what a senseless death. From my understanding, it was a fender bender. The young lady got mad and told him off and called her friends. They come beat the guy up and somebody stabbed the guy and he died. Alfredo, again, was an employee of mine for 10 to 15 years. I sent condolences out to his wife and two daughters. Again, just totally, totally senseless. Happy Father's Day to all the fathers. We're going to have a nice little Father's Day show. I had the opportunity to interview a guy named Todd Melnik, right? Todd, I met in Alaska, and he was the lawyer. This story is on Netflix. You got to turn to Netflix, right? The movie is called Long Shot. They try to set this guy up. I think he was Mexican. Try to set him up. And if he hadn't been at the Dodgers baseball game, this guy would be doing life in prison. And I run into the guy, Todd, who was his lawyer. And he gave me an opportunity to interview him. And you're going to watch this a little later, too. So I hope you enjoy it. But it just goes to show you how crazy this system is. If this guy is supposed to be over his grandmother's house, and the lady who was the prosecutor in L.A., she had won like 29, 30 straight cases, putting people on death row or whatever. And this guy has been on death row, so I hope you enjoy it. We have the honorable Theodore Ted Pretty Boy Blunt. What are you doing, man?
It's always a pleasure to be in your company.
Happy Father's Day.
Thank you, sir.
How you doing, Rob?
Hey, I'm doing great. I'm here with you two guys here. It don't get much better than that.
Let me start with you, Ted. Ted, we had an impromptu conversation, right? And you know, a lot of times we get on here and we talk about fathers, right? And whatever fathers they mean to other people. But I think that I've been a good father. I think Rob has been a good father. You have too. But you told me, you said that you've been married for how long?
For this August, it will be 60 years.
Ain't that? Wow. 60 years.
60. 6-0.
Wow. So how did you and your wife meet?
We met in high school. She saw me playing basketball because she came to a basketball game. She still knows nothing about basketball. She thinks 2 points is a field goal,
gotcha.
Not 2 points. She saw me and my best friend in high school, his girlfriend and my wife were best friends.
Right.
So next thing you know, we hook up and I get the opportunity to meet her parents, sit down at their table.
So it was a difference then. So you had to go meet the parents almost.
Yeah, absolutely.
Back in the day.
Yeah. I walked her home from Simon Gratz High School. It's like 5 or 6 blocks. Knew everybody in the neighborhood. And then when we got there, her mom had cooked dinner. Now, my mom couldn't cook bread.
Right.
And her mother could really cook.
Okay.
And the moment that I sat down at the table with her parents and her family, and her, I was hooked. I mean,
wow.
The food was unbelievable. Next thing you know, my mama's eating at the house. My sister's eating at the house. You know, my brother's trying to sneak in. We would be at the kitchen table before her family would get there. That's how good the food was.
So, I think this is I think this is an amazing story. When you were telling me, I didn't know. So, okay, so you meet your wife, but then you go on to college, right? Because then you had... I mean, you got a scholarship or whatever it was to sell, right?
Right.
So how does that work?
Well, actually, we got married before I went to college.
So you got married when you was in high school?
Yes.
Wow.
No, I had just graduated in June, and we had gotten married in August. But we had been dating for 2 years.
Wow, that's amazing. And your daughter, who's now a congresswoman, Lisa Blunt Rochester, right. Your wife was pregnant with her.
That's right. But going into my sophomore year, Lisa was born. So I had a child my first year in college. But thanks to our family structure,
right,
her parents and my mother, we were able to sustain those 4 years with me going to college for 4 years.
Wow. That's deep. So now you're a megastar, right? I mean, once it settled. I mean, I know we could kind of act like it wasn't, but I mean, trust me, I went to Winston-Salem and I didn't know how big a star Ted Blount was until I went to Winston-Salem. So now you're on college campus, right?
Right.
So was you coming home during the summers? Because now you got a child while you're in college.
And no job.
Wow.
So that's because the family structure provided the kind of income that we needed for both my wife and my child for those 4 years. Without the family structure, it would have been almost impossible for me to stay at Winston-Salem because I didn't have a job.
Wow.
So my job was to play basketball and to study and to graduate.
So ladies and gentlemen, we're talking about Father's Day, right? And this guy had to be a father while he was a student at Winston-Salem, while he's playing basketball, his wife is home conceiving his child, and but the family structure.
Right.
Right, the village, right?
That's right.
Wow.
And my second child was born April of 1965. I graduated in May of 65. So I had two kids before I even finished college.
Wow. Never knew that story.
Mm.
And I worked for a year, and then my third child was born, and I was going to graduate school.
Wow.
Did you do that at Winston-Salem also?
No. At Winston-Salem, I had... two.
Now I'm talking about your graduate. I mean,
graduate school. It didn't cost. I had gotten a scholarship again.
Okay.
And they gave me money to go to school and also to take care of my family.
Good deal.
So for 6 years, I was able to go to college for free.
Where did you go to grad school at?
I went to Rutgers University School of Social Work.
In New Jersey.
In New Brunswick.
New Brunswick.
So I commuted from Philadelphia to New Brunswick for 2 years.
So now, because now you're home taking care of your child, your children, right?
But the first year, I didn't have a car. So you either catch the train, the bus, subway in order to get to Rutgers the first year. The second year, I was able to have enough dollars to buy a car. That brought a brand new car.
And people never know sacrifices.
Yeah. Oh.
You know what I mean? Yeah. I mean, you're very wealthy now. So, I mean, you would never see those days again, my friend. This guy, trust me. He makes money now. I mean, like, literally, like, in his basement, right? Like, he stands up with hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of dollars.
It seems like that.
Ted, this is a really nice story, man.
Yeah, yeah.
And you got an opportunity to play basketball with the great Earl Monroe. You guys were in the backcourt together. And you played for the great Big House Gaines.
Right.
Right? So, I mean, even like Tiny Archibald, how all you guys became friends?
Well, actually, Tiny is, like, maybe 8 years younger than me. Tiny saw me as a basketball player because I used to go to New York and play. And playing against the guys in New York, there's a fellowship and a bond there. Then the little guys or the younger guys see the older guys playing, and they want to emulate or be like some of them. And so Tiny saw me just like he saw a lot of other people. And so to this day, Tiny and I are close. And Tiny now lives in Delaware.
And you know, people didn't know that. Tiny Archibald lives down here. You know, older folks who are watching this can appreciate Tiny Archibald because they think basketball was invented by LeBron James and Stephen Curry. I mean, guys like Tiny Archibald really could play.
That's right.
So let me, God, I'm going to get to you, Rob, but let me stay here for one second. Big House Gaines is, ladies and gentlemen, you just got to Google some of this stuff. I got an opportunity to meet Big House Gaines. Ted introduced me to him, and matter of fact, he signed a book for me.
Sure.
Was we in New York? I forget where we were. I got a chance to interview Mr. Lloyd, who was the first basketball player, right? So I got it. Then a strange thing happened, right? I got to tell this story. So we're down at Bancroft Middle School. I don't know if you guys ever heard of Wally Jones, but I kind of idolized Wally Jones as a player. I think he played for the Sixers, right?
76ers.
So these guys are playing this basketball game at Bancroft. My mind. Wally Jones comes down, throws the ball behind his back. A guy jumps. Wally Jones lays the ball up. After the game, I asked Wally Jones for his wristbands. Because back then you would ask them for like their wristband, their headband. Because it was like, wow. Ted Blount, now he's the president of council. He takes me to CIAA tournament, and he's walking around. He's walking on water. I mean, it's crazy. You know, I was like, who is this guy? I start kissing his ring. It's so crazy. I was like, I start combing his hair. I didn't know who the heck he was, right? So we back there with me, Wally Jones, And Curly O'Neill.
Curly Neal
from the
Sam Jones.
All these guys are legends, right? Man, I'm back there with these guys. I'm a basketball guy, right? I'm in awe. So first, Curly Neal's like, I learned how to dribble from Ted Blount. I'm like, ladies and gentlemen, if you don't know Curly O'Neill from the Holy Grove Trotters, please go. You gotta go. You can't make this stuff up. Sam Jones, 11 championships with Boston Celtics, bragging about this guy. So I go to Wally Jones. I said, Wally, I remember you was at Bancroft, and I told him the story about that movie. He said, that wasn't me. That was Ted Blount.
Yes. Yes.
And yes. Ted said, I thought you knew that.
Yes.
I said, man, I'm going to give you your wristband back. Is that a true story?
That's a true story.
I was in the gym. I saw Ted do that. So when you just said, Wally, I'm like, Ted did that. I was in there. So
but they almost look alike, right? Yeah. They could pass as brothers, right? Or maybe they're both yellow. I don't know.
Yeah. Yes.
But am I right?
Yes.
Yeah, you're right. Yeah,
I mean, and then to hear Curly Neal brag about you, right? And the great Sam Jones. I mean, so basketball was just a different time then.
It was a different time, and it was a different kind of friendship. So whereas today you see great athletes, but the friendship is not there. Mm-hmm. You know, we might know one another,
right?
But there's no linkage at all. For instance, I mean, Wilt Chamberlain, mm-hmm. you know, I mean, I rode in his car.
How was he to be around, Ted?
If he liked you, great. If he didn't like you, he didn't say anything.
Wow.
Yeah.
Sonny Hill said that he was a great entrepreneur and he knew how to handle money too.
Let's just say Wilt Chamberlain had more money than dirt.
That's what Sonny Hill said.
So when the Sixers traded him to L.A., he ended up purchasing about 250 acres of land. And that's where he built his house at that time for $2.5 million.
Wow.
And then he built houses all around him. All of that belonged to Wilt.
Wow.
So most people don't know mm-hmm. how wealthy he was. Mm-hmm. Still don't know how wealthy he was.
Wow. So in the day's time, he would be like a LeBron James.
He'd be bigger than LeBron and Michael.
Wow.
He was mythical. I mean, how many people can you think of that could score 100 points in a pro game? That's like Goliath.
Yes.
Or to get 46 rebounds in a pro game, that's mythical. Or to average 50 points a game in an NBA season. To average 30 is hard. 50 is impossible.
And I think people forget, even with Tony Archibald, he averaged the triple-double 1 year, didn't he?
Triple-double. The only man to ever lead the league. He led the league in scoring and assists.
Wow.
The same year.
See, ladies and gentlemen, you don't get that nowhere else but here, you know? That's interesting.
Let me ask you this, though, Ted. It was the fact that you guys, a lot of northern players was migrating down to play for Big House.
That's a good question.
You know, was that, you know, you kind of made it special that you had, I mean, look how many guys got passed up here that no problem, let's go down here and make a career.
Well, the difference was integration. Mm-hmm. In the North, most schools only accepted maybe two black ball players. Mm-hmm. In the South, no black players went to Southern schools.
Right.
So I went to school from 61 to 65. 67 was the first year that the ACC accepted a black ball player.
Yes.
67.
Yes.
Who was a McClendon? I heard about him a lot. He was a legendary coach, right?
Yeah, he started out at North Carolina College, and then he went to Tennessee A&I. At North Carolina College, they won 8 CIAA championships.
Wow.
Then he goes to Tennessee A&I. They won the NAIA 3 years in a row. That's a national championship.
And they say the story is like he went go and play like North Carolina and beat them, but you never saw the games.
They played Duke.
Duke.
And but again, it was at a time when whites and blacks were not allowed to play together. So therefore, there were no participants there to actually see the actual games. Mm-hmm. But they would play against one another. And a lot of them learned things from McClendon.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
They said that he was like the innovator when it came to the fast break and all that kind of stuff. So I guess he and Big House Haynes had some rivals, right?
Yeah, because Big House was coming along, but he mentored Big House.
Oh, wow.
So again, as House became really good and really famous, we would play against his schools. Like one year we played Kentucky State when McClinton was the coach at Kentucky State, and we won the game. Mm-hmm. Coach Gaines beat him when he was at Tennessee A&I in order to go to the NAIA.
Wow.
So you had what was called District 29. You had to win that district in order to go to Kansas City.
How was it playing with Earl Monroe?
Oh, Earl was perfect. You know, again, his first year, Earl probably averaged 2 to 3 points a game. Because, again, you had so many other good athletes going to historically black colleges. So Earl, the second year was great because the guys that were in front of him were gone.
Mm-hmm. Oh, got you.
Yeah, so they graduated. Mm-hmm. So when he got to be a sophomore, he was able to play. But Earl was upset because he didn't play his first year. And he called his mother and said, "Mom, I'm thinking about transferring, you know, because Coach Gaines isn't playing me." And so Coach said, "Well, let me speak to your mama." And Earl left the room. He talked to his mom. His mom said, "Boy, you keep your butt there. Whatever Coach Gaines says, you do it." "Yes, ma'am." Hung up the phone. And then his sophomore year, he and I played together in the backcourt.
Mm. Ladies and gentlemen, only on Community Crossfire do you get these kind of stories, right?
Yeah.
I mean, so, God, Rob, I almost want to talk to you. I'm
like, "Oh, yeah, you can keep talking to Ted. I'll keep joining in, but look here, right there." Yeah. Wow. Man, that's incredible.
Is that incredible?
But like you said, when you just said that story about him going there and laying, I was sitting in Bancroft in the front row, and I'm like, "Ooh, did y'all see that?" It was crazy.
And most people didn't realize that was the beginning game before the Boys and Girls All-Stars. Mm-hmm. So our boys then played the second game. And that's when we started the Boys and Girls All-Star game in 1970.
Hey, Ted, when you were coming through, right? So there were only a certain amount of blacks, I'm assuming, that could play in the pros, right?
Oh,
or
sure.
Was it like an unwritten rule?
When I was coming along, for instance, Earl Lloyd was the first, and you had the opportunity to meet him, and since then he has passed away. The average team after that only had 2 black ball players, and then it started to change.
So did you have an opportunity to maybe go to Globetrotters or something like that?
Well, I had an opportunity to try for the Globetrotters, and I had an opportunity to go try out with the Knicks. I went with the Globetrotters initially, but I went out there without any sneakers, any shorts, any jock strap, because my plan was to go to graduate school. It wasn't to play basketball.
But you had a plan.
Yeah, I had a plan.
Big Hells Gaines told me to my face, you were this, and this guy coached hundreds of players, said you're the smartest player he ever coached. That had to make you feel good, right?
Oh, absolutely.
And he even put that in his book.
Yeah, well, I mean, you get an opportunity. Most people think that I went to school on a scholarship. Did not go to school on a scholarship then. Went to school with the promise of getting money to pay for your education if you made the basketball team.
Wow.
And up until September 30th or October 1st, I didn't have a meal ticket, did not have a place to stay, but I was on campus until we had an alumni game. And the alumni played against the varsity.
Did you ever get a chance to play at the Rutgers League in New York?
We played against them in the summer.
Okay.
It's always a Philadelphia-New York game.
Was the guy Pee-wee, was he still playing? I hear a lot about him.
No, he's younger than me.
Okay.
Yeah, way younger.
Because he got a lot of stories. Him and Julius Erving, those guys all played,
right.
Played Rutgers. So did Sonny Hill play Rutgers then? Or?
Yeah, Sonny played. When I came along, Julius Erving played with like junior high school kids. Tiny Archibald played with the like elementary group. So you had different levels. Mm-hmm. And I was playing at the college level.
So those guys were watching you play?
Yeah, probably so. Yeah.
You see how this works with Community Crossfire? We come here and talk about Father's Day and against the basketball and legends. Legends. But this is, you know, and people don't know. Like, I would watch what Ted and those guys were doing with the leagues. And that's how I formulated the idea of Storm's Classic. And I would even pick your brains.
Well, because we stopped in 1985. Mm-hmm. We started in 1970. We did it for 15 years. We started initially with just the boys. And then 4 or 5 years later, we then incorporated the girls in the process. The difference was, when we started, we made sure that the team was represented of the city. Mm-hmm. So therefore, it wasn't all black kids being on the basketball team.
That's right.
So therefore, we said we will make sure that there was room for whites, blacks, or anybody else that wanted to play upstate and downstate.
Right.
And then when we had the girls, initially, all white girls, because black girls really weren't playing basketball then, mm-hmm. or they weren't playing at that level.
Who was involved? You were a major then?
It was me, Major, Roger Dean, and Maurice Pritchett.
Wow.
Yeah.
What is Roger Dean doing now?
Roger Dean passed away last year.
I didn't know that. Yeah. Sorry to hear that. He was another good guy.
Another good guy, really cared about the community.
He did, man. Yeah. I tell you, he loved Charlie Smith.
Charlie Smith was phenomenal.
And you know, people forget those kind of guys, right? Yeah. I mean, he was phenomenal. You know what I mean? Right?
People forget a guy by the name of Eric Fuller that went to Howard High School.
Yeah. Eric Fuller from Southbridge.
Guess who he played for in college?
Rhode Island, right?
Cleo Hill, Essex County College. He was the second leading scorer in the country.
And Cleo played in the CIAA, right? Cleo, he's a legend, right?
Winston-Salem was the first black number one draft choice from an HBCU.
Is he still around?
No, Cleo also died.
But listen to these stories, right? People just don't know. Yeah. I mean, like, again, I heard a lot of them because you took me to the Legends Breakfast, right? I mean, to be honest, you really did show me a nice time. But I was absorbing that history. Yeah. I mean, and people don't realize to get an opportunity to interview a guy like Mr. Lloyd, right, on this show.
Yeah, I know.
On this show. I mean, it was phenomenal. And then he signed the book. I mean, it was, God, I wish I had that tape because he was telling some really stories, some good stories.
I mean, when he was playing in the NBA, black ball players could not even stay at the same hotels mm-hmm. as white ball players. Mm-hmm. Most people don't even realize that. Mm. The salary structure was different for black ball players and white ball players.
Do you have a question, Rob?
No, I'm just absorbing because I've heard Ted's name. I tell you, I was working for the Boy Scouts of America. I was in Tidewater in 80, and I went to the CIAA the first time I went to it when it was at Norfolk. And I was with a guy, his name was Walter Davis. He went to St. Aul, played football, but he knew knew the players there. And we were out one night, and he ran into Earl and said, "Hey, Earl," and they knew each other. And I'm like, that's Earl of Pearl. I mean, he had his two-seater Benz parked right in front of the hotel and all that. And he was like, "You guys need to come down to, we got a suite down at the beach."
Wow.
"We got the hotel down at the beach." So after that, we went down there, and I got home like 6 in the morning.
Wow.
But it was just a beautiful time, man. Earl was great. I mean, but it was just him knowing my man that went to St. Aug. And they knew each other from that time.
People forgot about the time when I ran basketball clinics with Earl, Jim Washington, Wally Jones. Coming to Wilmington, we did a clinic at Bancroft. There were 400 kids there at a clinic. Mm. They stopped the traffic so Earl could drive his Mercedes down the street. The kids did.
Yeah.
And when he got in, they just went bonkers. You know?
I mean, but again, people sometimes forget, you know, and that's why I'm glad you are bringing this up. You know what I mean? Because you had A.J. Englison playing for you, too, at one time.
That's right.
Right?
Mm-hmm. A.J.
That's good stuff. Hey, Rob, let me divert for just 1 second. How's the school gone since Dr. Newton passed away? Over. Rob, for those of you who don't know, this is my brother. He's a teacher. He works at Warner School as a disciplinarian. And I know they just named something, I think.
They named it. Dr. Newton's Way, that stretch right in front of the mm-hmm. school. Then they just did a park bench across the street in his honor and a tree they named for him. Newt had done tremendous. I mean, I've been at Warner 21 years, and he's been there the last 3. And when I say somebody came and turned that whole thing around, he did that.
Wow.
This year going
like,
in.
They said it was like the principal on Lean on Me, like Mr. Clark.
Oh, yeah, he could have been that. because you look up our scores in reading and math was number one in the elementary schools in all of Red Clay.
Wow.
Before he got there, that was unheard of. Unheard of. Because their thought pattern of Warner was, it's Animal House. Mm-hmm. And we was up. Now, the teachers there was like, why don't they come? They saying that, but they not really here seeing this. We had some challenges like everybody's, but it wasn't crazy off the hook like everybody's throwing books and stuff. But Newt came in there like, hey, my name is Newt. I didn't want to tell you. And that was his theme. And he turned that thing around.
But that was all more about engagement.
It ain't no question.
If you get principals to think community first, yep, school second.
Yep.
Because you're there basically to serve the community. What he did was he touched people with little things like, your clothes aren't clean, let me make sure that they're washed. Mm-hmm. You need a haircut, let me make sure that that's done.
Yep.
You need somebody to call mama, that's what I'll do. Mm-hmm. Oh, I need to be around on the weekend, I'll be there. And when you get principles like that, it makes all the difference in the world. And again, I worked in Red Clay for a number of years. Principals that worked for me, they did that. Mm-hmm. Made all the difference in the world. We had the Positive Learning Center, where you send a kid if he or she is acting up. Or you had the ILC, where they might have had a special needs problem. But you start by engaging them. Find out what they like to do. And the same with the teachers. And it starts out with communicating with them. Mm. Something as simple as, how was your day?
Hey, it's called engagement. I worked over there with both Reggie Lacefield and Tom Roberts.
That's
so
right.
I worked on both sides of the aisle there. And I know when that's how I ended up at Warner. They ended up shutting Tom Roberts' side down. And they moved that whole staff around. So I ended up at Warner, and I've been at Warner ever since. But I could still, it's some of those students that graduated there that I see now with kids that, you know, when I was campaigning and I was bumping, they're like, oh, Ollie. And when you leave PSA, they said, that guy helped me through. He taught math and he stayed in my butt. But I had nowhere else to go because I couldn't get suspended. I was in the alternative school.
It wouldn't have been nice if they voted for you.
Well, it would have been. Maybe another time.
But again, it's sort of like,
got to go there.
I mean, you think about it. I mean, I didn't get involved in politics until 84, 85.
Uh-huh. Do you guys, I'm going to have to deal with, like, say, foster kids? Did you ever have to deal with the homeless kids?
Yeah, you know.
Sure. I was in charge of that.
Yeah.
So let me ask you a question. So say, like, somebody adopted a foster kid or a homeless kid, right? Now, say the mother or father was out there, or just the mother. Now the sister or somebody takes over those kids. Now the kids are acting up over here who they adopted or whatever. And they're like, what I do now? They can't send them back, right? What do you do? Who do you get involved?
Well, that's when you're counseling, if you have one, if you have a good counseling program, that person either then addresses the kids' needs at the school, or they're able to deal with an agency that can come in to deal with the kid and the parent.
Yes. You gotta get an agency involved.
That's right. Well, you gotta have a linkage.
They need some services, for sure. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Because, I mean, you know, one of the biggest things, I hadn't had it as much this year, but in years past, I had a number of great-grandparents that was the sole caretaker. And you was like, my Lord, just understand that for me. The great-grandmother was the caretaker of that youngster.
She's probably 60 years old.
60. She may be 70. And I'm at and that's at the elementary level. They're trying to, you know, hold it down for that, you know, trying to keep that family together. And that, again, that's that structure is trying to hold on. But the you know, that mother and father is out there doing their own crazy thing. But she is looking at, this is my grandchild that I need to see if I can get them through while I got enough time. Mm. And I got the energy to do it. So I just always commended those folks when I met them.
Ted, do you think one of the big transitions was desegregation? Do you think that really split our communities?
It depends on who you talk to. It both, by definition, could have been a savior or it could have been a failure. For instance, integration meant that where you had a black restaurant, that might have had to close down. Where, you know, you had a black store, maybe that had to close down. Where you had a black pharmacy, that maybe had to close down. Where you had medical people in the immediate area, maybe that's all gone. The connectedness is now missing. So before, when people were forced to live together, they were able to create a lot. But when you all of a sudden you say, oh, all of these opportunities are here, maybe that connectedness is now gone.
Well, what's one of the biggest changes you've seen in 21 years?
Well, you look up, and Ted just said it. I mean, all of my elementary teachers, the black ones, lived in the neighborhood. I mean, I could walk around a corner and see Miss B, who lived at 1300 B Street. We used to call her Miss B, but she was the fourth grade elementary teacher at Bancroft. I mean, at Palmer. So, you know, Mr. Rideout and them lived right up here in Rosegate. You know, they were close.
And Mr. Smith was like the principal, and he lived right over.
You know what I mean? Yeah. So that was a little bit of difference. I mean, and Wilmington was his own district. That was the Wilmington district I went out of high school, and it was still the Wilmington district.
But you got to remember then there was a requirement that you be a city resident.
Yeah, I understand. Yes.
Residency requirement.
Yep.
When we eliminated residency, we created a monster.
Yep.
Because now, instead of it being a residency thing, it's a person that's coming in from outside.
Yeah. So then, it used to be residency the go-to of Wilmington School?
No. The people that worked in Wilmington,
that was
the workers, were residents.
We kind of let the police and fire dictate that. And they went to legislators. I mean, you know, we were on it at the same time. And first, when they first did it, it was really about Jim Seals being the first black man. Remember they had the billboards and the signs, you know, merch. It was horrible. It was horrible. 92, 93, right? Mm-hmm. And then when Jim Baker got in there, he cut another deal. So, I mean, it's just been like a spiral.
And then when Dennis Williams got in, they cut another deal.
Dennis cut another deal with his. Yeah, so, I mean, like, I agree with you. Yeah. I agree with you with that.
I mean, I just think that if you don't live here, you become what is called, by definition, an occupation force. So you're here because of the occupation versus you're being a resident and having an investment in the community.
Mm-hmm. That's deep, man. Mm-hmm. That's deep. Well, thank you, man.
I did go to class.
So you were in the National CIAA Hall of Fame too, right? You were showing me that picture?
Oh, that's the National Historically Black College and Universities Alumni Hall of Fame.
Well, and not many people were in that. Nobody I know.
Nobody in Delaware.
Now, I would think that A.J. English should go in there, right?
Again, but I wasn't in there as an athlete. I was in there because of the work that I had done in the community.
Oh, right. Okay, I got it.
Because I was the board president of Winston-Salem, member of city council and president.
Oh, got you.
You know, chair of the Neighborhood Civic Association.
So was it just basketball?
No, basketball's not. That's at the bottom of the list.
Wow, that's pretty cool. Yeah. So you're in there with, you know, the big boys, man.
Hey, what can I tell you? Yeah.
Happy Father's Day, Rob.
You know, I definitely just want to give a shout out to my two girls,
sure.
Erica and Adriana, you know what I mean, love of my life. One's grown, one's a rising junior at CAB, and she likes to remind me that, can you believe I'm a junior? I say, can you believe you're going to get out?
Right.
But I love them to death, man, you know, so I thank God for them.
And for me, I mean, all three of my daughters, they're all grown, you know, mm-hmm. all married or were married, mm-hmm. all doing well, all out of my house. I mean, so that's phase one. And then I have five grandchildren. Ooh. Four of them already have degrees, ooh. And one is going to Columbia in the fall, so that's Columbia University.
Yes.
So I've been blessed coming from a family where no one had gone to college before me. And my mother and my wife's parents basically saw the value of me getting an education and paving the way for family members after me to be able to have a legacy. So now I can look back and say, my grandkids have gone to college, mm-hmm. my kids have gone to college, they're all doing well. That's the blessing. That's the legacy. It's
absolutely.
Not really about me anymore.
Absolutely.
It's about them and then what they're bringing to the table.
Yep. Okay.
And so for those that have families, just remember, it ain't about you anymore.
Yep.
It's about those that are going to follow you.
That's right.
And in closing, I give a shout out to my kids, Norm, Naya, and Jermaine. Of course, these guys love my life. And now my kids, now through my extended family, you got Trevor, LeVar, Scoop, and Cedric. So, like, it's a village now. Ladies, thank you guys. We got to do this again. It was kind of quick.
Man.
Stay tuned and watch Todd and the movie Long Shot. It's on Netflix. You're going to watch me interview this guy. I mean, it's a fascinating interview that I did when I was in Alaska. And he
gave me an opportunity to interview him, and I thought it was tremendous. But the movie is on Netflix. Oh, wow. And Todd Melnik, Todd, I hope I'm not butchering your name, because I'm going to send you this tape of this show. Watch the movie Long Shot. If he didn't get involved, this guy would be serving life in prison. And it just goes to show you how the systems could somehow ruin people, because there's a lot of people who are doing time in jail that shouldn't be, and this guy would have been.
And to your point, Norman, the criminal justice system is something that we really have to look at, because when you talk about justice, the ones that are in jail don't have just cash. So when you look at justice, think about just cash as well, because if you can't afford representation, you're not going to get justice, and justice is the goal.
And I thought Richard Pryor put it in the best way. When we go looking for justice, you see just us. All right, I'm out of here. Community Crossfire, another point of view. We're back intact.
Ground ball up the middle.
I love baseball. I can't say that enough. Every time I'm there, I soak it all in. But I wasn't supposed to be at that game. It was like any other day, but as soon as I opened the door, I was completely surrounded, like SWAT style. My daughter, she looks up and she says, "Dad."
I told him, "I'm gonna get you out of here." I asked him, "Do you remember where you were?"
I was at a Dodgers game.
I gotta find the holy grail of Juan's defense. I need to place my client at Dodger Stadium on that night. Juan remembered they may have been filming something there that day.
The episode was that I picked up a hooker in the carpool lane and took her to Dodger Stadium.
We were in for an enormous fight. The prosecutor they assigned to the case had never lost. She liked to pick off people with the death penalty. I looked at tape after tape.
We shot in two sections in Dodger Stadium.
There's 56,000 people at this game. How could you possibly be on camera?
I wasn't supposed to be at that game, and that would play in my head over and over.
I looked for eyewitnesses and the tickets. I could not afford to miss anything.
The kids wanted to know when I was coming home, and I didn't have an answer.
Welcome to Community Crossfire, another point of view. I'm your host, Norman Oliver. Wow, what an amazing time we're having. I have an amazing guest. You know, we interview people around the world, around the country, and I meet this guy in Alaska, and I'm going to interview him in 1 minute. First, I want to thank my sister for hosting my show the last couple weeks while my wife and I have been traveling. And I tell you, one thing's been disturbing. I've been reading some of the things that's been going on in our city. How do this slumlord, A.J. Bocorny, stay in business? This guy was a slumlord of mines when I was getting out of college. He was a horrible landlord then. He's a horrible landlord now. You guys don't inspect his properties. You let people live in these infected homes. I mean, it's just amazing to me what's going on in our city. But I don't want to bring Todd in to our madness in Delaware, and he's way in California, and I'm being him in Alaska, and I'm interviewing him in Canada. So this is kind of amazing. So ladies and gentlemen, let me set the stage, right? So I meet this guy, Todd, and he tells us about a show that's on Netflix, Long Shot. We look at it, my wife and I, and you know, so many people get railroaded, right? In the judicial system. And this guy takes this young man's case. And if it's not, I want you to watch this show, Long Shot. You got to go to Netflix. You got to watch it. If it's not for this guy being at a baseball game, he may be in jail now. How you doing, Todd?
I'm doing all right. What a wonderful day here in Vancouver, and what a wonderful cruise we just had.
That's right. It's been amazing, man. So first of all, welcome to Delaware. And you know, people watch this show around the country, and I thought watching the story was amazing. And thank you for giving me your time. Todd, walk us through it. How did this happen?
Well, It's a complicated story, and of course, watching the movie will be, you know, will help everybody understand the complicated facts in a very compressed 40-minute movie. But what happened was that a young girl, 16-year-old pregnant girl named Martha Puebla, was murdered for her testimony that she gave against a gang member about 11 days earlier before her death. And her murder was ordered from the jail by the people that were involved in that original murder. And the detectives never bothered for more than 2 years to listen to the recordings to find out that they had arrested the wrong man. Mm. The murder was unsolved for several months. And then the chief of police, Chief Bratton, who many of you probably have heard of, came down on the rank and file and said, you know, this is a stain, a black eye on Los Angeles. This 16-year-old girl was murdered for testifying against, you know, another murderer. We cannot let this stand. And so LAPD went out and pressed to go and find, you know, who the murderer was. And they went and talked to the same gang members that were responsible for the murder. They were mad at the guy that killed did the original murder, that ordered the hit on Martha, was mad at my client, Juan Catalan's brother, Mario. And he ordered, basically, his gang members to point the finger at Mario's brother, Juan, my client, because mm-hmm. Mario was already in custody with the guy that did the murder. So, without doing any investigation whatsoever, the LAPD Special Investigation Squad, which is known as the Death Squad, because they kill more suspects than they arrest in this high-end tactical force, took him down in front of his daughters, his 4-year-old and 6-year-old daughters, and his girlfriend on his way to work in front of his dad, and held him for about 9 hours until they told him what he was arrested for, and then they didn't give him his Miranda rights correctly. But he didn't know anything about who he had supposedly murdered.
Let me ask you, because we're going to jump a little bit. How did you get involved? Did you just read it in the paper randomly? Because you could have known gang members.
He had heard about me from a cousin of his that worked in my office. And I had done another very high-profile case that took me down to Singapore and to Taiwan for a murder case that happened in the Century Plaza Hotel in Los Angeles. Mm-hmm. And his cousin had seen the work that I had done. He said, well, you better call Todd. Mm-hmm. And Juan initially tells a story that, man, I don't need to know about any lawyers. But as soon as he got arrested, he was like, what was that guy's name?
Right.
I'm going to need this lawyer.
Right.
And so he called me, and then I was actually up here in Canada when I got the phone call from Collect Call. And he said he had been arrested for murder. And I said, hey, don't talk anymore on the phone. Don't talk to another person in custody. Just keep your mouth shut. I'll be back in 2 days. I went to the jail, and he's just sobbing through the glass. Like, I don't even know who I'm supposed to have killed.
Is this a pro bono case you were taking at the time?
It ended up being pro bono. He paid me a small fee because his brother had already been arrested on this other murder.
Right.
And Juan was not a gang member. Neither was Mario. But Mario was associated with the gang members, and he had been driving a car. And so he got locked up. But they didn't have much money because the other lawyer took all the family's money. So they gave me a small amount, and I took the case. Mm-hmm. And by the time I got him out, he'd been in for almost 6 months. He didn't have anything. Mm-hmm. So I gave it back to him.
Wow. So the prosecutor in the case, right, she was notorious for getting people the death penalty. Ladies and gentlemen, you're watching Community Crossfire, Another Point of View. I hope you're enjoying this interview. And you need to watch the movie Long Shot on Netflix. It's amazing. And we're talking to the lawyer who was involved with the case. You know, we bring you all kinds of shows from everywhere, and this is one of those cases. So, Todd, so the prosecutor, I did a little background check on her. She's always won cases.
She had never lost a murder case until she met me.
Well, but you know what? But that don't make it right. The way I looked at it, and I could be wrong, and I don't want to say anything backwards, but it sounds like they set some people up, or they just, I mean, evidence are not shown sometimes, and if they don't have the right legal representation, you got people in jail that probably shouldn't be in.
There's a lot of people like that. A lot of people don't have the resources or the lawyers that are going to go out and do the hard work in order to exonerate a client. It's so much harder when somebody points a finger and says, this is the person I saw kill so-and-so, it's hard to undo that and to show that reasonable doubt. Mm-hmm. But we used video footage from the Dodger game. We used the cell tower records to show that he was still at the game at the time of the murder. But the most incredible thing about this case was that he was within probably 100 yards, maybe less, of the murder at the time of the murder.
Oh, wow.
And the way that I was able to prove that he didn't do it, because the prosecutor obviously was saying he was there at the time of the murder, is because there were four or five other kids that were talking to the girl that was murdered. And they all had cell phones, and they all had cell phone records and all that. So I was able to place the time that they were there with Martha. And all of them, when I interviewed them, said that the shooter had been circling the block and then parked for more than half an hour prior to them leaving. And then within minutes, he got out of the car and shot Martha right in the face.
Wow.
And so Juan's cell phone records showed he was still at Dodger Stadium at the time that that car was still circling the block.
I thought it was fascinating. If you watch this, right, if this guy is unable to produce a ticket, which he couldn't find originally, but it was some footage from HBO that put this guy at the Dodger game. But if he doesn't, if all this stuff doesn't fall in place, this guy could still be in jail.
He got the tickets to the Dodger game the day before. Mm-hmm. And he asked his mother to go, knowing full well his mother was not going to go to a Dodger game. And so then he took his daughter and he took some friends, but the tickets were handed to him for free. Had he not gone to that game, had he not gotten those tickets, his alibi would have been his mom saying, he was home with me watching the Dodger game. So where do you think Juan Catalan would be today?
Wow.
Without everything falling into place?
That's amazing. And you were involved with another high profile case, OJ case, in some kind of way?
I was the first lawyer, the first talking head ever hired by the networks. As soon as OJ got arrested, I was contacted by ABC, and I started doing local commentary, and then that turned into a full year and a half job working for CNN and ABC and Paramount Pictures. I worked on a TV show called Hard Copy.
So how was that experience, Todd? Tell me.
It was fantastic. It was a lot of fun.
Right.
I had known, one of the reasons why I got hired and why I think I kept staying on is because I had tried many cases in front of Judge Ito. Marcia Clark, when I was a prosecutor, just was down the hall from me. Mm-hmm. I had tried cases against Johnny Cochran and against one of his associates. I knew Bob Shapiro. So I knew everybody that was involved in the case. And so I was stationed basically at the courthouse, and I would get the inside scoop from everybody that I knew what was going to go on. And so I was able to predict what things were going to happen, what was going to be brought up during the day. And I looked like a real genius.
Did you think he was going to get off?
I did. What happened was that I was working for Hard Copy at the time, and Vincent Bugliosi, who was the Manson prosecutor at the time, was the special guest that was supposed to talk after the verdicts were read. I went on national television the night before, on Friday, and I predicted, I said, look, if this jury comes back quickly, OJ is going to be found not guilty.
Wow.
If this jury is going to convict him with nine black people on the jury, they are going to spend a lot of time debating this and going over every fine point and making sure that no stone is left unturned, and before they're going to convict, you know, this superstar, O.J. Simpson. And sure enough, Tree came back in, 4 hours?
Yeah.
And said, not guilty.
Was this guy, Bratton, he was the chief of police then too, right? Who was the chief of police?
Bratton.
Is he still around?
I don't think he's actively working, but, you know, he obviously was the chief of police for New York, and he did some of the Olympic stuff, and he's been very high profile for a very long time.
Wow. Ladies and gentlemen, we bring you shows from all over. Wow, we're in Mississippi, we're in Texas, we down in Canada, and stuff just falling in our hands. We got a high-profile attorney here. Now, I'm glad he's my friend, because I might need him to represent me in Delaware.
No, no. While I was on board, I got contacted for a murder case in Georgia.
Wow.
Yeah.
Oh, so what was this Singapore, and what was going on in Singapore? You had to go to Singapore.
I had a Singapore Airlines flight attendant that was accused of murdering another flight attendant in the Century Plaza Hotel. Mm-hmm. For those of you that don't know, the Century Plaza Hotel was one of the premier hotels in Los Angeles where, you know, Ronald Reagan and Nixon and all the presidents would stay. This was the premier hotel in Century City. And she didn't make her flight, and she was found dead in her closet with the TV on. And so they, based upon voicemail messages, they had accused my client of, you know, being the rapist and killing her. So it entailed me going down to Singapore three times in the course of, gosh, I don't know, probably 2 weeks to interview the flight attendants that were on the flight that they had originally been on. And they were coming in from all different places around the world, and I had to interview all of them. And so I had to keep going back and forth. I also ended up going to Taiwan because there was some glasses that were left in the girl's room that apparently didn't belong to her. So I was looking for potential other suspects, and I wanted to find out if those glasses from the family, if the glasses belonged to her or didn't belong to her. And so that was the case, and it made international news. Wow. As well.
Wow. What more can I do for you? What more can I do for my audience? First of all, Singapore is a really nice place, right?
It
very clean, right?
You guys should go. It's really nice.
But it's a big difference from Taiwan, though.
Oh, Taiwan is smoggy. The air is bad. Yeah. It's just sweltering hot when I went. Singapore is really a nice place to go.
Yeah.
It's very up and coming. It's very modern. It's quite nice.
Did you ever hear what happened in Singapore where the guy something with chewing gum and messed up their whole system?
Well, I know that you would get lashes for chewing gum, spitting it out.
Yeah.
You can't spit on the sidewalk. You can't chew gum.
Yeah, yeah.
You can't even have gum in the country.
It's your boy Stormy Norman. I'll bring it to you. Todd, thank you so very much for taking time out of your busy day. I really appreciate it.
It's my pleasure.
Thank you, man.
It's my pleasure.
Watch Long Shot on Netflix, ladies and gentlemen. And stay tuned to Stormy Norman live on Community Crossfire.
We got to pay back. Get back.